Good morning, and welcome to worship on the fourth Sunday in Lent at St. Luke's Episcopal Church in Long Beach, California. And whether you're here with us in the sanctuary or joining us on Facebook Live, we're glad to have you here. Today, in the life of the Church's Gaudete Sunday, or in the Church of England, Mothering Sunday. It's the Sunday when, in the middle of Lent, we're supposed to remember that each Sunday is a little Easter, and God wants us to rejoice. So come, rejoice with us as we gather in worship this morning. And if you are close to St. Luke's at 7th and Atlantic in Long Beach, join us this afternoon at 4 p.m. for Choral Evensong, where we really will have a chance to rejoice. Thank you for being here this morning, and worship will begin soon. Blessed be the God of our salvation. Jesus said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you.
Mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. God be with you. Let us pray. Gracious Father, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, came down from heaven to be the true bread which gives life to the world, evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Joshua. The Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have rolled away from you the disgrace of Egypt." And so that place is called Gilgal to this day. While the Israelites were camped in Gilgal, they kept the Passover in the evening on the 14th day of the month in the plains of Jericho. On the day after the Passover, on that very day, they ate the produce of the land, unleavened cakes and parched grains. The manna ceased on the day they ate the produce of the land, and the Israelites no longer had manna. They ate the crops of the land of Canaan that year. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Moisture must dry up as in the heat of summer. A reading from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. From now on, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So Jesus told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me." So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son had gathered all that he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here am I, dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.'" So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his slaves, "Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And they began to celebrate. Now his eldest son was in the field. And when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has got him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, "Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you. I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him." Then the father said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier. Amen. From now on, We regard no one from a human point of view. We once knew Christ from a human point of view, but we know him no longer in that way. Here in the middle of Lent, through this passage in Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, we get a glimpse of the resurrection and the transforming power that has come into the world. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Everything has become new. What a profound sense of optimism in Paul's triumphant shout of glory. But when I look around at today's world, everything doesn't always seem that new. It's as if we repeat the same old mistakes over and over again, and then we wonder why nothing changes. Yet things do change, sometimes slowly, sometimes more quickly. And especially for those of us who are followers of Jesus, or as Paul puts it, for those of us who are in Christ, we have a special call to continue changing the world. Paul uses the word reconciliation to describe this change. And he explains it this way. What is new has come from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Did you guys catch that? God has given us, the ministry of reconciliation. And therefore, Paul says, we are ambassadors for Christ. That's a pretty serious responsibility. So I decided I'd better figure out what reconcile or reconciliation means. So off to Google I went. First, the word reconcile comes from the Latin meaning to bring together again. That makes sense because through Christ, we are brought back into relationship with God. We most certainly can say that it's a healing in the breach of a relationship. So a reconciliation can be a healing in the breach of a relationship. Second, reconciliation is not the same as forgiveness. The Joyful Heart Foundation writes that reconciliation is the final step in the forgiveness process, but it is the cherry on top, an extra bonus when and if it occurs. This also made sense to me in the context of today's lesson, as Paul writes, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. Now that our trespasses, or that's another word for sins, have been forgiven, they're no longer seen by God. So God goes further and reconciles creation to the divine. And Jesus himself taught reconciliation when he says in Matthew's gospel, so when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, go leave your gift there before the altar and first be reconciled to your brother or sister and then come and offer your gift. Jesus could have said, forgive your brother or sister and then come offer your gift. But instead, he said, be reconciled. Jesus wants the cherry on top. As ambassadors for Christ, I was taught in the conservative evangelical tradition that we were supposed to encourage people to accept Jesus as their personal savior. And in that way, they would be reconciled to God and not go to hell. And this lesson, what Paul is teaching can be understood in that way. But reconciliation isn't just about our relationship with the divine. It must be extended to include our relationships with those around us and to include those within larger communities as well. God has entrusted the message of reconciliation to us, and I'm absolutely convinced that God is present
when we work to forgive each other and to heal broken relationships. So with this lens, I heard today's gospel lesson a little differently this week. So first, some context and a quick recap. The parable of the prodigal son, sometimes called the parable of the forgiving father, is a third in a series of stories Jesus teaches after he's derided for welcoming sinners and eating with them. There's the parable of the lost sheep and how the shepherd will search diligently for one lost sheep out of 100. The parable of the lost coin and how a woman rejoices after finding one lost coin out of 10. And finally, the parable of the prodigal son, when the father rejoices as the second of his two sons returns home. When the lost are found and welcomed back into God's family, there is great rejoicing in heaven. Today's lesson is one of three such stories Jesus uses to illustrate his point. And so now, recapping this morning's lesson, a second son goes to his father and asks for his inheritance. His father gives it to him. And the son runs off and blows it in a foreign country. There's famine in that country, and the second son ends up feeding pigs and probably wants to eat the pods that he's giving to the pigs, but no one will give him anything. He figures he'll be better off at home, even living as his father's servant, than sitting in a pigsty. He practices his "I'm not worthy" lines and makes his way home. Father sees him coming, son essentially asks for forgiveness, and the father arranges a huge party to celebrate. Older brother is in the fields, hears the party, finds out it's because the second son is back, and is furious that there should be such a lavish feast for his recklessly wasteful brother. The father says to the older son, "We had to rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." Very traditionally, this parable has often been interpreted to mean that the father represents God, who forgives the son unconditionally. The younger son, who now finds himself hungry, represents those who may have fallen away from God in search of new adventures or idols, but who are nonetheless forgiven when they return home. The older son may represent those who have been doing the right thing all along and then ask, "Why would anyone forgive such awful behavior?" There is an unwillingness to forgive, but they are nonetheless asked to forgive. So when I read this parable through the lens of reconciliation, I find something even more profound than the story of an extravagantly forgiving father. I hear Jesus asking us to push the boundaries of forgiveness into the realm of reconciliation, into the place where broken relationships are healed. Jesus wants the cherry on top. So perhaps we're meant to represent the father, who could have simply forgiven the second son and let him work as a servant. But instead, the father puts a fine robe on him, places sandals on his feet, and prepares a huge party. It's way more than an act of forgiveness, right? Of course the father has forgiven the son. So what we're witnessing is an act of reconciliation. The son's trespasses go unseen, and the healing of the relationship begins. Frankly, it would be very hard for me to be as generous as this father. Some kind of punishment seems merited, but this parable also reminds us that reconciliation looks beyond retribution. Then there's the older son, who is, and perhaps understandably so, angry with his father. It seems that he may represent someone who's resentful because a person has been forgiven. Again, some punishment seems merited. But when you think about it, the older son hasn't been harmed at all. It's the father's right to forgive and to reconcile.
But there he is, making it all about himself. The father attempts to heal this breach as well. "Come on in, my son," he might have said. "Join the party and welcome your brother with me. I have loved you with my whole heart, and I will continue to do so. And all that's mine is yours. But today we must celebrate. What was lost has been found." The father attempts to reconcile with the older son and to bring him into his joy. We don't know if the older son went to the party. I hope he did. But we do know that the father shows us another example of reconciliation when he invites this son home too. This is just like some of Jesus' other teachings, isn't it? Go the extra mile, turn the other cheek, love your enemies. Don't stop at forgiveness, I can hear him saying in this parable. Push on toward healing broken relationships. Keep working toward joyful reconciliation. Paul boldly claims that we are ambassadors for Christ and that we have been given this ministry of reconciliation. It will be different for each of us. It might mean reconciliation between people and God, between people and people, or even people and creation. I'll admit that sometimes I'm not even sure how to get started or what needs to be done. But the Theology of Work project has inspired me with some ideas. For there to be genuine reconciliation, we must understand accurately what's gone wrong among people. We must truly understand the ills of the world, and they suggested that this can start with one simple act: listening. Just listen. We're blessed that that's one of our Lenten themes this year. We must also love other people and work to see them as equals rather than judge them or disengage from them. And disengaging from people in this day and age seems to be really, really easy for us to do. But no person is an object to be exploited, enslaved, eliminated, or ignored. In our tradition, we say it this way: we will respect the dignity of every human being. And we must continue in fellowship with each other and with Jesus, sharing our hopes and dreams, encouraging each other, laughing with each other, and caring for each other. From this community, we will take our ministries of reconciliation out into the world. We are ambassadors for Christ. As our Lenten journey continues, may we grow ever closer to Paul's great vision of glory. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Amen.
Please stand and join as we affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only Son of God,
eternally begotten of the Father, God from God.
Yes.
forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray to God, who leads the lost and calls sinners home. We pray for creation, that the damage done to land, water, and sky may cease, and the Spirit renew the earth. Pray for creation. Return to the Lord. We pray for the world, that all may be safe from oppression, discrimination, famine, and war. Pray for the world. We pray for the people of Ukraine and for all those whose lives are being disrupted or destroyed by Russia's military aggression, for all those who are working for peace and democracy, for all refugees and immigrants, for an end to violence of all kinds. Return to the Lord. We pray for the church, that it may reconcile the wounded, gather wanderers, and guide pilgrims to you. Pray for the church. We pray especially for Michael, our presiding bishop, and our Bishop John. Return to the Lord. We pray for St. Luke's, that we will be an example of stewardship, justice, mercy, and love. Pray for this church. We pray for our clergy, Jane, Antonio, Dean, Beryl, Peter, and Steve, and for our vestry and staff. Return to the Lord. We pray for those whose souls thirst for you in the watches of the night, that you will keep them safe in the shadow of your wings. Pray for those who suffer. We pray for our homeless siblings, for all those whose lives and livelihoods are affected by COVID-19, for Amos, Deborah, Kim, Shelley, Stacy, Beryl, Gary, Charlotte, Jason, Deming, Michelle, Debbie, Joan, Phil, Christine, and Tom. Return to the Lord. We pray for those who have died, that they may rest in you, and for those who mourn, that you will caress their hearts with compassion. Pray for the departed and those who mourn. We remember especially Mona Rodriguez, Roy, and Lori Stevens. Return to the Lord.
Gracious God, we have wandered far from your presence. Lead us back through the wilderness, that we may return to you and make your heart our home. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
We're going to do special blessings now. Do you want to come on so we can...
Okay.
Now, there you go.
Thank you. My name is Mohumuza Amon. I'm one of the refugees that were living in Kenya. And I'm so happy to be here, seeing you in person. I've been hearing about you, this church, St. Luke, and all the support you have been sending us food, sending us rent. And I'm here to say thank you so much, St. Luke Church, for the support you gave to us. We really appreciate. The rest did not have a chance to come, but they will come next time. Thank you. Be blessed.
God, who creates everything new but always make us celebrate big time birthdays and anniversaries together. We bring to you Pat and Alan, who are not only celebrating their birthdays but also the 37th anniversary of their love. You have been with them throughout. We ask you to continue to be present with them in their lives, giving whatever they need to live that full and wholesome life individually and as a couple that you created for them to live. Guide them, walk with them, show them mercy and love and all the wonderful things they deserve, and give them a spirit of celebration so they could enjoy the great gifts that you have given them throughout their lives as individuals and as a couple. And I bless you in the name of the creating, redeeming, and sustaining God. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Happy anniversary. God of love, we bring to you your lovely son, Luis Eduardo, who is in open hearts asking you to allow him to lead the example of San Arnulfo Romero. So as you go through life, you think about others, the unconditional love that comes from love for the community and love for himself. Guide him and protect him and show him the path so he could live that life that is wholesome and full that you have prepared for him. And Luis Eduardo, I bless you in the name of the creating, redeeming, and sustaining God. Amen.
Amen.
Do not neglect to do good and share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast. That fervent in prayer and in words of mercy, and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all of the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name.
Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we have fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He has stretched out his arm upon the cross and offer himself in obedience to your will, a perfect self-offering for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Thank you.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. This is the Lord's table, and all are welcome.
The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Bow down before the Lord. Grant, Almighty God, that your people may recognize their weakness and put their whole trust in your strength, so that they may rejoice forever in the protection of your loving providence, through Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
We'll say it, so mostly today's announcements are a music day. A music day of gratitude for this morning, for our choir and our interim music director, David Tinoco, and then for our continuing blessing at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Come back, bring your friends, bring your family, bring people who have never heard of or experienced Evensong, because if you don't know it, you need to try it at least once in life, and tonight is your chance. 4 p.m., there will be a reception after, and one of the further enticements is our new music director, Dorita Seth, will be with us for Evensong to check out his singers and to meet the congregation. So if you have a chance to be back, you will be blessed by beautiful music and a chance to meet our new music director. So it is a good day as we celebrate Rejoicing Sunday in Lent. And there will be a reception. Do you need anything, Joyce and Glenn? Nope, you are, of course, they're all set. Why would I even ask? So there will be a reception, and it's a little bit of Easter today. So come and enjoy the bounty that will be set before you. Judy has her hand up. Come to a microphone or you won't be heard. While Judy's walking, I'm simply going to call your attention to the calendar in the bulletin. And if you don't have one or you're new here with us today, these little purple cards that are in the front and back of the church have all of our special program offerings for Lent. They are also, if you're with us on Facebook Live, available on our Lent page of our website. And several of them are on Zoom. So whether you come physically or you want to join by Zoom, there are Lenten programs for you. Judy.
Thank you. I want to particularly welcome Amon here today and thank him for coming to thank us. Because we've been apart for so long and there are many new people to the church, I want to put his remarks in context. For about 8 years ago, St. Luke's began the process of sponsoring refugees from Uganda who were escaping a whole lot of terror there. They went into refugee camps in Kenya, and then when all refugees stopped being welcomed, we had probably, I think, 15 came. Tom Crow and Amy Valenzuela did all the major work of helping the people get resettled. Then there was about a four-year hiatus when no one came. But St. Luke's continued to send little bits of cash assistance to the people that had been slated to come but could not come. And Amon was one of those. And maybe 6 months ago, Amon and four other gentlemen were able to come and be the last refugees that were sponsored by the Episcopal Church with St. Luke's as the primary sponsor. They are all doing so well. Amon just finished his CNA and got his certificate and is waiting for his license. Henry is working as a social worker. They just hit the ground running and have done so well. And those of us that have worked in the program a little bit are just so proud of them all. But I just wanted to add a little bit to Amon's remarks because there's been so many changes in St. Luke since the program started, and also with COVID, everybody has been so absent. So I am so grateful that Amon came here this morning specifically to thank St. Luke's for the ongoing support of the Ugandan / Kenyan refugees. Thank you.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.